The clinical theory of everything is my attempt to draw together from a number of different sciences the answers to the big questions in science and the challenging questions in healing arts, where we see things that are not possible happen all the time. So we're going to talk about a few of the factors that come together to answer those questions today. Various states of matter, what I call the phases of health, photoenergetics and biophotonics, and plasma vessels. States of matter. We're all familiar with solid, liquid, and gas. You can see on the chart the standard phase diagram for water. Well, as science advances, we find out that we didn't know everything. If we look back in history, at whatever point in history we look, we see scientists being very certain of their knowledge, of their state of knowledge, that now we know it all. And that's the nature of the human mind. But for example, in this diagram on phases of water, we now need to add easy water, or as I would call it, a liquid crystal phase of water between solid and liquid. Liquid water as a bulk water, H2O, does not form ice. It can be super cooled and not form ice. It has to go through another structure first of sheets of hexagonally structured water. That's not even H2O, it's H3O2 minus and in multiple quantities, almost endless, any number of quantities. So beyond that, there's the states of matter that would be further to the right, plasma at higher energies, and at lower internal energies, the state of condensate or Bose-Einstein condensate toward the left. On the next slide, we see an image, an actual photomicrograph of a condensate. So in a condensate, you have multiple atoms of, could be the same mineral, in a very low energy state, where they're all the atoms are in the same quantum energy state. And what happens in that state is that they function as a single atom, as a single quantum, instead of discrete material object like atoms, you have a field, an energy field, that shows the functional characteristics that we see in the quantum world. At the other end of the spectrum, you see in the next slide, a plasma ball, powered by a Tesla coil. And we'll see little Birkeland currents that we'll talk about later, those lines of energy discharge. Plasma has actually within it three states of function, a dark mode where we don't see any light being emitted. We have a glow mode where there's light coming out, and a discharge mode, which is like lightning and electrical spark discharges. And they're quite different, so we could even say those are a couple more states of matter. Plasma. The term plasma for this state of ionized gas actually was named after the liquid plasma of biology because of similarities in function with the electromagnetic spectrum and how they move. The physicists were looking at how the Birkeland currents of energy come into the poles of the Earth and form the aurora borealis, and the aurora moves a lot like those fingers of energy in the plasma ball. And it's all very biological in its movement. So the mathematics of the physics are quite complex, and we're just beginning to understand that there's actually cylindrical layers that are concentric around that in that field, in that discharge, and that the multiple, that two of those lines of discharge will actually attract each other at long distance, and then at very short distance they'll repel each other. So there's a preferred relationship where you get a double helix of two Birkeland currents or plasma discharges wrapped around each other. And it's where these go through what's called a Z-pinch or a Bennett pinch in plasma physics, is where on a cosmological level where we generate the extreme density of matter to form a star. It's a very different understanding of star formation and cosmology, but actually much more explanatory than the conventional one. And so if we look at in the biology, we see a similar function happening where the plasma in our blood vessels always come in pairs. We have the artery and the vein within what we see here as a neurovascular bundle. A very similar structure and function to what we see in the cosmos. The cosmic plasma here is shown on the next slide with the Birkeland current coming into the pole of the planet and stimulating a discharge mode, a glow mode of the gaseous plasma, the ionized gas in the atmosphere. Different gases will form different colors within that because of the specific quantum energy levels in the orbitals of those atoms. And we see here on the scale of the solar system how the energy flow comes from the sun to the earth. It's guided by the shape of the magnetic fields into the poles of the earth to form those beautiful northern lights. And that energy doesn't flow constantly. It changes, it moves, and it comes out in current sheets from the sun, as shown in this diagram. When we sent out the space probes out further out in the solar system, the Pioneer vessels, when they got to the edge of the solar system, what's called the heliopause, where that outward energetic flow from the sun, where it ends and you enter into a different, very different field of galactic plasma flow, you can see on the graph here the sudden changes as you got to that end. And that at the end of a plasma vessel are what we call a double layer. And this is equivalent in biology to the double layer at the cell membrane. And then again, taking a step out on a further fractal level to larger scale, we see the galactic plane in the center going horizontally across, and we see plasma vessels above and below that are energized by the outflow of energy at the poles of the galactic center. So there's a continuous current flow from the center outward into those to energize those plasma cells, cellular structures of plasma, and then that distributed current that fills the plasmoids then condenses into on all different scales, at least 16 orders of magnitude different scales from the biological to the cosmological, these Birkeland currents that we see flowing in our body through the blood vessels structure that forms around those and the meridians that flow in the connective tissue, the extracellular fluid. Finally, here's a view of that current flow as it's interpreted by plasma physicists and electrical engineers, looking at how the cosmos works on an energetic level, as opposed to the conventional view, which is a gravity-only materialistic view, but not understanding the energetics of electromagnetism, which is 38 orders of magnitude, 38 to 39 orders of magnitude, more powerful than gravity, And on a cosmic level, cosmological scale, the reason that the electromagnetic energy dominates rather than the conventional view that, the cosmos is dominated by gravity is that these plasma vessels are linear in extent, and therefore the magnetic fields that they put off that attract each other and that they drop off much more slowly than the R squared of a point source, which is the same for gravity or for electrical fields, R squared, 1 over R squared. But a linear source, the geometry is different, and therefore it's much more powerful over larger scales. The fields extend out much further. So that was a fundamental error that that was encountered, you know, in the 19th century, trying to understand the cosmos as we look out there and saying, well, gravity must be the most important thing. Well, no, it's not. It's quite weak, actually. Just take two magnets and try to hold them right next to each other, North Poles facing, and you'll find out how much stronger gravity is, than magnetism can be than gravity. 38, 39 orders of magnitude. So let's look at this other phase of water, the fourth phase of water, or easy exclusion zone water, it's being called also by the researchers. It's, again, not H2O, it's H3O2-, and here's the difference in structure. On the right, we see the coordinated structure of hexagonal oxygen, hydrogen, coordinated lattice structure in sheets. Those sheets are liquid, so they can take up different the shapes of proteins, shapes of the cell membrane, and they form multiple layers. They could form millions of layers, not just, you know, sometimes hypothesize that there's structured water organized around biological systems, maybe four or five layers. No, millions of layers in the laboratory confirmed. And it can form in order of a minute. And it forms by absorbing light. Infrared and ultraviolet light are what structure these. So at the other end of the spectrum, we have condensates, the spirit minerals. The Bose-Einstein condensate was given the 2001 Nobel Prize in Physics for research showing that Bose and Einstein, the physicists that proposed this low-energy state of matter, could exist, and yes, it does exist. It exists at low temperature, near 0 degrees Kelvin in the laboratory, where we can create it, and it operates, again, unlike other matter, it's superfluid, superconducting. It can levitate out of a container. It can flow through what appears to be solid matter. It has a mind of its own, and it is the state of matter that we propose carries the mind, carries consciousness. That's what the alchemists tell us that work with producing this matter from standard matter. They say it's the substrate of consciousness. As we change it, it also changes us. When we ingest it, it changes our consciousness. And so it's a mutual evolution. So we know now that many different condensates exist for photons even, and that photon condensates have mass. One model of a condensate of a photon is the electron. If we take a photon and we wrap it on itself into a half wavelength path, it forms the precise field of an electron, because the magnetic field is contained. That gives us some a little bit of inertia and resistance to movement that we call mass. And the electrical field is directed outward, and that's the electrical field of an electron. There are many other examples, which we won't go into in detail. They're not particularly relevant in the biological system that at least I don't know exactly how for some of them. But we do know that the qualities that they share of superfluidity and superconductivity, whether apparently in a liquidy state, a more dense liquid state, or in a gaseous state, is critical to understanding the conscious body and how it operates. And the fact that this entire extended object, this macroscopic object, has the characteristics of a quantum object. In other words, it can go from here to there without moving through the space in between. It can do so instantaneously. It can move through apparently solid matter, in and out of that solid matter, and just as the ghost does with the body, the conscious body does with the biological body. We have what's called fermionic condensates, which are Cooper-paired electrons, is the example that is relevant to us, that when we have the structured water, or when we have the structured water contains pi electrons, and there's many, many of them, and they form a sheet of equivalency that becomes a pool of electron energy that's a waveform acting as a single quantum rather than separate quantized electrons. And we have the same thing of pi electrons taking that form in DNA, potentially, the pi electrons of the sugar molecules. So we propose that that state produces a coherence zone that also will attract the condensate forms of the transition minerals that the alchemists we're working with in modern alchemy and clinical alchemy to feed and heal the spirit body, the conscious body. Because basically, if we combine these two concepts of a plasma and a condensate, they're at opposite ends of the spectrum when we think in terms of heat or entropy. The concept of entropy is tied in with the concept in physics of the forward arrow of time. At a macroscopic level, we see that entropy always increases. Well, okay, what we can measure, the entropy always increases, but when we measure from our limited perspective of conventional science, we look at the universe and we say, but there's something that's increasing that we can't measure, and we call it dark energy. So I model that as, and it exists in these cells of space that's between all the material substance of the galaxies, it's coherently empty of matter. Oh, it's an exclusion zone, isn't it? So in these exclusion zones of space, we have a coherence zone, we propose, of what they're calling dark energy, and so it's a plasma, but it may be, or at least it's a coherence zone, a condensate. It may be a low internal energy. I don't know that we can measure that yet. But that appears to be the source of the exclusion of protons, just as the biological water exclusion zones in the body exclude protons. That may be the case in the cosmos as well, and that may be what forms these vortices of the galaxies and the charge separation, as in the body, charge separation is formed by the structuring of water and the exclusion of protons and the negative charge that's held in that water, and therefore a battery effect that can actually literally operate the chemical reactions of the body without having to eat food. There are a number of cases on medical record now documenting that that is a state the body can be in. So if our water is in that state, it can absorb light from the environment, and we can do all of the chemistry that we need to do in order to maintain life. We can live on light. We're photosynthetic beings, potentially. Okay, so those Cooper-paired electrons are, in the normal state of matter, we look at two electrons in each orbital having opposite spins, and each one is unique. They have a separate spin, a separate state. They're quantized, they're separate. Slightly different levels of energy. And so in the Cooper pair, they're not separate, they're equivalent. They become a coherence zone of electron energy, electron field, rather than two separate electrons. And when we have many of those Cooper pairs of pi electrons in DNA or in structured water, that is a perfect substrate for attraction of the minerals of consciousness, the spirit minerals, the condensate minerals. Okay, I was mentioning that the in a condensate, when it's exposed to an electrical field, the electrical field passes through, but a magnetic field approaching a condensate will be resisted. There's a Meissner field, it's called, that opposes any change in its magnetic state. And we have the opposite with plasma. A plasma will, because it's a conductor, acts as a Faraday cage, which means it'll shield electrical fields, it'll ground them out, and that happens in the skin. Our skin is a Faraday cage for the internal parts of the body. Whereas a magnetic field, we know, will pass right through the body. So there's a complementarity to these two states of plasma and condensate that together, I propose, in a biological system, in a conscious biological system, will oppose change from the outside. And therefore, it won't interact. It compensates for the fields that are imposed on it and resists being changed, resists interaction. And that is an explanation for what modern physics terms dark energy and dark matter in the universe, I believe, based on universal consciousness of these cellular voids they're seen as. Well, is it a void or is it where the source, is it the source? It's in the center and all the matter's out on the outside excluded from that zone. So I'm looking at it in parallel with our biology and saying, I think that's the source. And that's what the cosmologists are saying too, that's the source of whatever is making the universe grow from, and that's, we interpret the findings differently, but again, from the conventional point of view, the universe is expanding. Why? Because dark energy is expanding in these bubbles of dark energy, excluding the material substance of the galaxies where we live, onto the cell membrane of that cell. It's a cellular structure, cell in the generic sense. Cell, there are cells of plasma called plasmoids. There are cells, and 99% of the matter in the universe is plasma. But, okay. So let's move on to coherence zones. I've been talking about coherence zones a bit, and that they organize these, what we've thought of as separate things or electrons or atoms, into a macroscopic form of the quantum functions of the world, a macroscopic quantum non-locality. Non-locality is the term that's used conventionally for the function of the quantum world, where an electron, for example, can go from here to somewhere else without moving through the space in between. There has a non-local, has a field that extends out to infinity. They look at it as a probability field. It's really a possibility field. So it can go from here to there. And that happens, we've been able to measure that with remote healing and remote viewing experiments, that there is a transfer of quantum energy to a remote location, can be thousands of miles away, not within visible range, not line of sight. It's not a transmission of energy of energy waves. It's not dependent on the speed of light. It's a real-time transfer. So it's more of a scalar, or as the Russian research would call it, a torsional energy effect. So there's coherence zones not only in the structured water that we've been talking about, but also in the cell membrane. When the cell membrane is in a coherent state, we're conscious. When we disrupt that coherence of the cell membrane, we lose consciousness. That's what happens with anesthesia. And so there's membrane lipid rafts that bind to microtubules that hold the structure of the cell and that act as the portals through which nutrients come in and out of the cell, or through which they're blocked from coming into the cell when we enter a stress state, a toxic state. So the cell can break down those toxins if they're biological and restore the coherence. Let's talk about the phases of health now. We've talked about states of matter. How does that relate to the five levels of health in the phases of health model? From low energy state, where we are susceptible to viruses, chronic degenerative diseases, and cancer, to phase two, slightly higher level of energy, but still where the cell is just working on trying to replete its energy level and restore the structure of the energy of water within the cell, where we rejuvenate or where we rapidly age, depending on the direction the energy level is going, where our enzymes are coming into function or not functioning, depending on the direction we're going, or where parasites and bacteria can come in with their enzymes that are different than ours and be able to utilize at a lower energy level that same food that we're not able to break down. In phase three, we move up to a level where if we're healing, we're able to, the structured water is extending outside the cell from one cell and another and meeting in the middle with the distance being limited by collagen, extracellular cytoskeleton of the connective tissue matrix that every cell lives in. And so this is a new mechanism that we're proposing for extracellular detoxification, that those coherence zones of easy water will then begin to be confluent and to push the acidity, the protons, and the waste materials and toxins into the open-ended lymph vessels in that same extracellular space. If we're not able to produce that, if that energy level is going down and there's an increasing buildup of toxins and wastes in that tissue, that's when we supply the dead matter that fungus grows on. Same as in the external environment. You have dead matter, you have a dead tree, the fungus grows on it. We have dead matter in the body that we can't clear out. Well, we don't have the energy to make a new cell, to clear the space and make a new cell. The fungus grows on it because it can thrive and survive in that acid environment. And we see on the chart, it shows acid on the right, alkaline on the left, and this is as it's measured clinically in the venous blood. It's much more convenient than measuring it in the arterial blood, as you'd quickly find out. So then phase four, next level up, we're continuing to clean out the connective tissue. We've been able to regenerate cells. Now we're clearing the rest of the connective tissue. If there's an excess of toxins and wastes and allergens in the connective tissue, we have allergy and toxicity symptoms. And the final phase, phase five, is where we're working more coherently on an organismic level, responding to external environmental stresses, psycho-emotional stresses, life stresses. In the next chart, I just show examples of the biological corresponding organisms in those phases. We see the viruses attaching to a cell membrane in the lower right, where they're is such a low energy that there's none of this structured water on the outside of the cell membrane, and therefore a virus is actually electromagnetically attracted to that membrane, attaches on, injects its DNA or RNA, and we have the cell replicating that other RNA or DNA, making more viruses. In the upper left, at a higher energy level, now there's enough food for bacteria to grow, and you see bacterial rods growing there, so we'd call that an infection. But as Béchamp argued with Pasteur, it's the terrain that makes the infection. It's the susceptibility that makes the disease. It's not the disease that produces the conditions for the disease. The disease shows us that we've provided the conditions for that disease to appear. We all have bacteria in our system. Which ones grow is up to the terrain of the body that we supply to it. So that's a higher energy level because, you know, if you work in a clinical lab and you want to do a culture and sensitivity of bacteria, you can't use the same petri dish that you'd use to grow viruses. In fact, viruses are hard to grow. You need attenuated cells. You need a certain energy level of the tissue to grow that certain organism in. Similar with our lower right now, phase three, we see a fungal, beautiful fungal hyphae growth, reproducing in an acid and oxidized terrain, a dead matter terrain. In the upper right, you see a higher energy with green algae growth. And in the center, I've represented a mitochondria because that's they're healthy and functioning in that central balanced zone where in the original studies by Vincent in France, where he looked at the correlation of the cause of death, very, very high correlation of the cause of death with the type of water, the physics of the water that people were drinking in these four quadrants. And he only saw people in that center healthy zone who were young people in universities dealing with physical education. So very active and healthy and vibrant. That's where we want to get to. So, and the studies since then, whereas this is measured in the venous blood and the urine, the saliva, body fluids, the three factors that go into this measurement of the BEV or bioelectronics of Vincent are the three factors that determine the microwatts of energy in body in physiological fluids, in a fluid medium. And that's the Nernst equation that defines that. And if we look at it, we can look at what is measured technically, scientifically, but if we interpret that, if we look at what it really is measuring, what it really means, it's really about measuring the protons, the electrons, and the photons, the light energy, the pH, the protons, and the RH2, the hydrogen potential, the molecular hydrogen potential, because a hydrogen atom, H2, contains two protons and two electrons. So it's a measure of the electrons. And the next chart shows the an actual clinical diagram based on bioelectronics of Vincent, a bioelectronogram, and talks about the Nernst equation for energy in a fluid medium, pH, RH2, and you'd measure resistivity electronically, but that's really a measure of the ionization because it's only when substances are ionized that they have an electrical charge that can carry current and therefore reduce resistance to flow, or as we'd measured in a biological system, the impedance is the term for resistivity. And so that's really a measure of light energy. And that's what we measure every day clinically to see how the body responds to various stressors, signals that correspond to various environmental stressors or internal environment stressors and potential therapies, whether that would be colored light or an herb or some other medicine or even a thought form, an exercise. So here's phase one. You see the viruses, and again, that's the same biophysics of terrain of low energy, low electrons, low protons, low photons, where we have basically the potential to not be able to do anything. You don't have energy. You can have all the materials you need. You can't break them down. You can't build them up. You can't. You're dead in the water. So the viruses can come in. They're dead in the water too, but now there's dead water, and they can come in and attach to the cell membrane and trigger the cell mechanism. Degenerative changes, cancer, again, we just don't, a cancer is just a storage depot for wastes and toxins and acids and carbon-carbon bonds that we haven't been able to have the energy to break down. So when we increase the energy level, just as in the 1920s was done with various forms of oxygen, increasing the oxygen level for the cell even was found to be able to revert a cancer cell back to a normal, healthy cell. Won the Nobel Prize in medicine, I believe, somewhere around 1931 or 32, Otto Warburg from Germany. So there's so much that, you know, has been discovered, but is it integrated? Is it being used? Well, in Europe, they use oxidative therapies, and we're starting to, some people do now here. But we need to put all these observations together to have a comprehensive clinical theory. The next diagram again shows up close the bacteria thriving where, you know, if our enzymes aren't working, theirs might because they have different enzymes. to do the same type of reaction. If we can't eat that, if you can't digest that food, somebody will. If you're not digesting carbohydrates, the candida will change its enzyme expression and start digesting the food that you're eating. And if you stop eating it, it'll start dying off, releasing endotoxins, and you'll feel bad, and you'll say, oh, I feel better when I eat that junk food. Feed me, says the parasite. And trust me, they have consciousness at their level, and it affects our level. Test all spirits, all thoughts are spirits. So to rejuvenate our own cells, we have to be able to actually produce the enzymes, and we need the energy to run those enzymes. And both of those things start happening as the energy level comes up, when the mitochondria are functioning. That's the key, getting the mitochondria going in phase one, getting the enzymes going in phase two, getting our tissue regenerated in phase three, cleaning house in phase four, and dealing with all the life stresses, hormonal stresses and life stresses in phase five. So phase three, regenerate. Here we see, in the outer image, you see the fungus in the center shows an image of an actual video of a cell regenerating, mitosis, one cell making two. You need enough energy in that one cell to make two healthy cells. So it's, again, a higher level energy than just a level of rejuvenating a single cell to make a non-functional or dysfunctional cell function again, repairing the cell. Now we're repairing the tissue. And phase four, cleansing, in the center is an image from a video that shows white blood cells at an energy level where they're active and they're moving around, and then it'll actually engulf a bacteria and any other foreign substance. And then phase five, balance, we see the mitochondria in the background, and in the foreground too, mitochondria. This is, there's some very wonderful, wonderful videos produced of the interior of the cell, including mitochondrial function, that are graphic, 3D graphic animations, and it's worth watching those, and then they're just showing the structure. But imagine if we could overlay what's happening photonically, energetically, where these mitochondria are giving off. We know they're structured as lasers, and that they give off laser light, and that they as you'll see in some of those graphics or in actual micrographs of living mitochondria in nerve cells, of them living on the microtubules, moving along the microtubules as a pathway. They're sending this light energy along those fiber optic functions of the microtubule. And the microtubule is the only proposed location, physical location, until our clinical theory model, was the only proposed location for memory of a human lifespan that could account for the amount of memory that we can remember. Where does it store? Oh, the microtubules were the answer in the ORC-OR model. A neuroscientist and a mathematician combined their brain power to put that together, and it's a wonderful model. And I believe what they've actually identified is the antenna between the physical body and the spirit body, which is where the actual memory has to be, because when the biology is flatlined, there's no memory function, but yet a person who's having an out-of-body experience where their spirit body is out of the biological flatlined brain and heart body can come back with memories of the experience. So that's the actual storage, is in the condensates, which makes sense because that's actually a system that's superconductive, and therefore the electromagnetic fields of a photon energy acting, moving as a phonon at the speed of sound and therefore integrating with thought and sound waves, has the ability to propagate itself indefinitely. There is no resistance to flow, and therefore it's immortal as long as that vessel, that holy grail vessel of the spirit body, remains intact. the thought forms that we form when we're in the biological body and able to navigate and make choices would appear to be immortal. So let's next talk about photoenergetics, the light energy that's emitted and received by the DNA of the mitochondria and the DNA of our cell nucleus. We need to consider that, again, we're coming from a culture that looks at the world and sees matter. It's a materialistic view. And we want a picture of the structure. And unless the structure's out of whack, we think everything's okay. Or, the microstructure, the chemistry, that structure, the structure of the electrons holding different atoms in a certain shape and form, and we can measure that. But there's, in modern physics, a quintessence, a five-fold symmetry of different forms of energetic presence. Matter, or protons, nuclei of atoms, is one of those. Electricity is another, and then light would be the third. And those are the three that we can measure easily. The others we can measure only indirectly, but we can observe. We can measure them with our consciousness because they are the substrate and the substance of our consciousness. Dark energy, I propose, is the consciousness, the energy of the photons and phonons, the quantum energy, the electrical and electromagnetic and electromagnetic flow of energy within these fields of coherence of the condensate minerals and in the biological body, how they coordinate with other coherence zones in the cell membrane and in the structured water and the DNA, and the dark matter, the spirit minerals themselves. The spirit minerals are, according to the patent work back in the 1990s by David Hudson, the typical state is that only 5/9 of the mass of these transition minerals, not metals, not because they're not in a metallic state, they're in a high spin state, orbitally rearranged monoatomic elements, he called it in the patent. And some may be diatomic. There's, you know, still much to be learned. but theoretically, some of them would probably need to be diatomic to be in a condensate state, according to physics. So he observed in the laboratory with these minerals in this state, which he was able to take from the metal into the spirit form, as I call it, the orm or ormus or condensate or M-state mineral state, the spirit mineral state. When they're in the spirit mineral state, they connect very differently than what we think of as material, normal substance of the universe. And again, the conventional cosmologists look at the universe, and because they're not looking at electromagnetism as a dominant force, they say something's got to hold these galaxies together and make them move the way they do, and we'll call it dark matter, and we think it's just acting based on gravity. But in fact, this is superconductive matter. It's going to carry electrical current through space and put out magnetic fields from these linear sources that tend to go in pairs. You know, just here's a supporting fact that at least 60% of all stars are being found to be binary stars. Why on Earth, why off Earth would stars mostly exist in pairs? Oh, because electrical discharge in space, in a plasma in space on all scales, at least 16 orders of magnitude that can be measured, tend to occur in pairs. If you have a discharge here and a discharge there, they'll attract each other over long distances, much longer than gravity can reach, and they'll get close to each other and repel each other from getting closer than that certain distance. And again, it's true on on all kinds of scales. You know, when you read material from conventional cosmology, they talk about these as very scientific. They have their own scientific terms. They call them stringy things. Talk about superstrings, right? Out of subatomic, subquantum level superstrings. But they look out in the macroscopic universe, they see stringy things, and they don't even notice that plasma physicists and electrical engineers know that those are called Birkeland currents after the plasma physicist Birkeland, who I think he had a Nobel Prize. So we need to get our heads wrapped around these different parts of physics, different states of matter, and then it starts to make sense. So dark matter, rather than being just missing mass to supply gravitational energy, is way, way more than that. It's superconductive matter that can bilocate. It can carry electricity through space. It can connect remote points like the galactic center and our sun, for example. Why is it that the energy comes out of the sun? Where does it come from? Now, the conventional view is still a 200-year-old model. It says, oh, it's a ball of gas that condensed out of less dense gas, because gas, right? Gas in space condenses into a ball. Put some gas in space. What does it do? It expands. It doesn't condense. There's something else going on. But what does condense that is, because you can't prove that in a laboratory. It's just conjecture. It's like, well, we're going to extrapolate and say that over the eons, that's what happened. It came together. No, I don't think so. There's no proof. It's an idea. It's an old idea. It doesn't work. So they're saying, oh, it came together, and it's so dense at the center that it's fusing. It's causing fusion because of pressure. It's, again, a mechanical universe view. It's that mechanical pressure that's pushing the atoms together from hydrogen to form helium. But there are powers that are 38 orders of magnitude more powerful, and it's called electromagnetism. Whereas gravity is, they still don't know what, but it's probably a form of, or an aspect of electromagnetism that we just haven't well defined yet. There's a couple models we could go into that work, that fit. We don't know which one it is. We can't measure that quite yet. It's too subtle. Not 38 times less powerful. 38 orders of magnitude less powerful. That's 10 times 10 times 10 times 10 times 10 times 10. So it's exponential. You know how, you know, if you double a penny every day, you know, at the end of the month, you have a lot of money. Well, that's only 31 times. This is 38 times, not doubling, but tenfold each time. 38, that's like a whole page of zeros. So whether it's due to a difference in with pressure under gravity. You know, we know there's compression. Yes, we can feel that. That's we're not questioning gravity. Gravity exists, but why and how? Conventional science has no real answer. There's conjectures. They're looking for the particle. They're trying to measure it with high energy particle physics, but there's the outside of an atom is the electrical field. And in the center is the protons, the magnetic factor. So it's the electrical field that's going to correspond to the pressure of one atom against another in a planetary, or, you know, as our, my foot is against the Earth. So that gravitational field is going to slightly compress the electrical field of one atom against another, because these are coherence zones. They have their own field, and they're going to oppose each other. And so the nucleus then, which is attracted by gravity downward, and the electrons which are being pushed upward by the matter below, is going to create a slight asymmetry in the electrical polarity of each atom. So that's one of the models, that field is the gravitational field, that the summation of all those fields. And as we once we understand how gravity works, it will help to begin explaining things like why conventional science says that asteroids are, that comets are dirty snowballs. But every time we take a picture of one up close or try to land on one they're rocky. There's no snow. But yet the density appears to be that similar to water ice. There's something going on with gravity that's a little different in that field. Now these are objects that are coming from the far reaches of the solar system, and so they're coming from an area of much more negative electrical charge relative to the sun, which is the anode of the system, the virtual anode, I think they call it. And so as it gets closer, then there's this electrical polarity, which creates the tail of the comet. There's, you know, the whole question of the distinction between comet and asteroid is really getting blurred as asteroids show cometary features, and cometary features come and go, and when we get to the comet, it looks like an asteroid. So again, the understanding the cosmos we live in, whether it's the quantum level or the astronomical level, begins to make more sense in this clinical theory view, where it also explains fundamentally why and how we can heal ourselves more effectively, and the importance of not only looking at a material level of structure and chemistry, but looking at the electronics, the energy fields, the things like microcurrent and pulsed electromagnetic fields that are being so helpful in adding to our approach to healing, and using them at non-invasive levels. And light, of course, again, non-invasive levels of light, and sometimes coherent light, laser light, but not at a level of damage, a level of energizing, a level of communication, biocommunication. And then, so we want to understand that there is this idea, this ancient idea of quintessence, which is coming back up again in modern physics, that, in order to explain things on a gravity view in the cosmos, we have to say there must be dark energy and dark matter, otherwise we can't explain it. It doesn't make any sense at all. So again, because they're assuming gravity is the dominant force, we're actually looking in the wrong place and looking for the wrong thing with this dark energy and dark matter, I believe. But I believe it is consciousness and spirit. So photochemistry, light is the bonding energy of every chemical bond. When there's a chemical reaction, it's an exchange of electrons, which change orbitals, which are at different energy levels, and the quantum energy in and the quantum energy out is what rules that reaction. If you don't have the energy, maybe you're in phase two, you don't have enough energy to digest the material in your extracellular space, and there's bacteria that are going to come in and eat that stuff, and you call that an infection. And we know that enzymes have the primary function of reducing the activation energy needed to form that activation complex of substrates, reactants. When you eat, you're eating light, ultimately. The energy that we live on, the ATP energy that our cells operate on, the conventional view, which is still true, but now is a parallel pathway to the photoenergetic pathway of metabolism. When we're eating those nutrients, we break them down, we send the basic building blocks to the cells, we can extract the photonic energy carried by the electrons of those bonds when we metabolize them oxidatively in the mitochondria. But we are eating light. We absorb it in the small intestine, which is energetically correspondent to the retina of the eye, where we absorb light directly. So in both cases, retina and small intestine is where we are eating light. You know, biological water absorbs in the infrared and UV, especially in the near infrared. So the near infrared therapies that are being researched and proving to reverse symptoms of things like Alzheimer's and Parkinson's, very, very helpful to understand this photoenergetic physiology for getting a clue of why that is so powerful and why it's so safe, why it's a therapy that's, you know, is going to be helpful from cancer to learning disabilities. Then the idea of coherence zone resonance, that the larger these coherence zones are in our system, in other words, higher energy level is, the more energy we have to directly run our metabolism. If we don't need to break down a molecule of ATP, that's chemical battery storage. Why use a battery if you're already plugged in? You know, if an enzyme is plugged in to that battery of water, if it's surrounded by millions of layers of energized water that has negative electrical charge, that's acting as one quantum, as a coherence zone, the energy, whatever energy is needed for that chemical reaction, if there's a high enough quantum energy available by resonance, it's available immediately. There's no resistance to the photoenergetic physiology. So, I mean, as contrast, let's say you have an enzyme and you need energy to run that chemical reaction. You don't have it available from the water directly. So now you need ATP. And because you don't have the water available, you don't have resonance where the ATP can deliver it through the water. The ATP actually has to find its way to that enzyme. And you have to have the chemical reactants at the enzyme. So you need like three or four things at least to be together, along with the cofactor, which could be multiple things, vitamins, minerals, that act as the energy quantum resonators in the enzyme for the reaction. So your reaction rates are going to go way down, even if you have the energy available somewhere. It's like insulin resistance. When you don't have that energized water on the outside of the cell, you still have insulin. In fact, you make more insulin because it's not working as well. You need 8 insulin molecules to stimulate 8 insulin receptors, and they have to find their way physically there and actually occupy the lock and key locus, the site at the membrane receptor. Whereas one molecule will instantaneously signal all 8 of those insulin receptors at the same time without even reaching one of them when the water is energized. And if the water is energized, further out it's energized, the less far the insulin has to travel and the more receptors it can trigger. So we're talking major, major efficiency differences. Which is why there's such leverage with these healing techniques. It's like a cascading effect. You trigger this one thing, like when we test energetically. We introduce a photonic signal, a resonance signal of a substance. The entire body instantaneously changes its level of impedance, of electrical conductivity, which means there's ionization happening of not even beyond trillions. I don't know how many molecules are changing their state, but beyond trillions, trillions of trillions, because there's trillions of cells. And it's happening in all the cells because we're measuring it throughout the body. So, and it's instantaneous. It's a resonance, cascading resonance phenomenon. It's like flipping the switch and the light comes on. All you do is flip that one little switch. Oh, all the lights in the stadium turned on. Okay, that's what that switch does. That's what we're measuring clinically. So better to find the switch, the right switch, and, you know, or this switch should work. It's not working. Oh, what can we add to it? Resonance, resonance, resonance. Oh, there it works. Find the one that works energetically through biocommunication, biophotonic communication, because it's non-toxic, non-invasive. It's instantaneous. It's very efficient. In Germany, where this work started in the 1950s with acupuncture, first they were measuring the acupuncture points for resonance before and after acupuncture treatment, and then they could see that, yeah, the impedance changed. It balanced. It balanced if it was too high or too low. It came to the same normal level of impedance on any acupuncture point on any person, if they were able to treat them successfully. And then they discovered by accident that a coherently resonating, properly resonating medicine in the field of the body, even through a centimeter of vacuum, that radiant energy field, the photon of photonic energy, light energy, was enough to trigger this cascading effect and the whole body would shift state. But unlike acupuncture, where there's a microtrauma that, that continues, stimulates a healing response that goes on for some days after the event, when it's just photonic, there's no trauma. You take the stimulus away, out of the field, beyond a centimeter of space, and its body no longer responds to that as if it's in its space. So it's a reversible observation, and therefore we can do a whole series of measurements without confounding the results. Photonic biocommunication, we look at on every scale. So a cell, you know, your body's a cell. It's a cellular organism. It's made up of systems, made up of organs, made up of tissues, made up of cells. The cells are made up of organelles. The organelles are made up of different compounds, different chemistry, you know, different biochemical compounds, et cetera, et cetera. The water is in these cellular states that can shrink and grow. The coherent zones are cellular. The states of plasma, the states of condensates in the cosmos and in our bodies are cellular as well. Again, in a condensate, you can have a macroscopic object like the spirit body that coheres with itself and acts as one quantum. And the same with the structured water. It acts as one unit. So it has, each unit has its center point. You know, if we're talking about gravity, there's a gravitational center. There's, you know, a point that's the center of gravity of the Earth. Even more so, there's a center of gravity of a condensate, which is acting as a single atom. And so it's acting gravitationally from that one point. And so it can, amoeba-like, it can climb out of, parts of it can climb out of, without violating any other principle of physics. You'll see a condensate in a beaker climb up the wall. Well, some of it's still down there and some is going up and it goes up and down and, you know, it's it's moving according to, it's self-organizing and self-directed. It has all the qualities of life, all the qualities of the spirit. And so each one has its center point, its eye. The eye of a vortex, the eye of a storm, the eye of a hurricane, the galactic center is an eye at the center of the galaxy, where there's this a bar magnetic field, and then there's perpendicular to that there's jets of plasma coming out both north and south poles, and perpendicular to that you've got the electrical currents, Birkeland currents of the two major arms of the galaxy carrying electrical current back into that galactic center. So it's actually a complete circuit within itself, electronically considered to be a model of a homopolar motor. And my model, my hypothesis of how and why that is that the galactic center, that a black hole that's hypothesized to be at the galactic center, which is like a center of gravity of something where they say, well, all the mass, all the matter must be right there at that point. I say, no. What about a condensate? In a condensate, the matter is all out here. It's macroscopic. And yet it has that single point, that unique point of center of gravity that is going to act as a single point, even though it takes up space out here. So to me, that's what's happening. I think the threshold point is the double layer, the edge of the field, where you'll have the field that allows you to make a maglev train, you know, that opposing field that doesn't allow a magnetic field to enter into a condensate.
There have been cases of people that have levitated.
Yep.
And is there any, did they write anything about how they did that?
It's generally, from what I've read, they're in an altered state. Their consciousness is in such an energized, heightened state that it's now the bigger field. Instead of, you know, our spirits are suppressed. We're lucky if we occupy half of our organs. Am I suppressing anger? Well, I grew up learning how to do that, so probably yeah. So if I can occupy myself, it's the occupy myself, yourself movement in the clinical theory of everything. So if I can occupy my whole biological organism and my field that comes out a centimeter that we can visualize on a Curlian photograph, or we can measure the, in the German studies, you know, where they're saying, oh, the body responds as soon as it gets close to you, even if it's a vacuum. There's a radiant energy field there that's me. So if I'm occupying all that, and if I can occupy other orbitals on, you know, like an atomic level, same here, we have other orbital levels. When we energize our electrons further out, they can form a plasma of electrons that are so energized that they can literally give off visible light. Now, some people are more sensitive to that, but there's been people in history where everybody said, that's a saint, I can see their halo. There's a halo. There's, in Chinese language, that head, that halo, is like the head of a comet, right? And there's the tail, which is the Birkeland currents in the body, and that's the pictogram for spirit. Originally, they've you know, over the years, over the centuries, they've codified it to be certain limited strokes, but it was shapes, and those have become more angular. So the original shape was not a square with squiggly lines and a dot in the center, but a circle with a dot in the center and squiggly lines. What's that circle with a dot in the center? What are those squiggly lines for spirit? It's interesting. It corresponds to how we model the spirit body in clinical theory of everything, and it corresponds to many, many, many observations, even to where, you know, a spirit can manifest a physical body. An angel or a human who's passed can manifest physically, and often it'll be just part of a body. It'll be like the head down manifestation, but it can be the whole thing for a time. There's so much we don't know, but if we can't even account for what what has been observed, it's like we're with blinders on, saying, oh, there's no spirit, it's just a mechanical thing, we're just going to give you these toxins and cut out the bad parts and you can go back to work.
Well, what I heard from you is that the electromagnetic law or field or whatever, magnetism is stronger than gravity.
Absolutely. Take two magnets and try to push them together when they're opposing, you know.
So then in that sense, if like our thoughts are magnets, we can think outside of gravity.
Oh, yes.
And then that's how meditation happens. But our conditioning is what blocks us from being able to think.
Yeah. And what historically, you know, the observed cases, it's not a controlling small kind of thinking. It's not like a left brain thinking of, I'm going to levitate that thing, you know. And even if you can, so what? It's a party trick. But it's when a person is in an elevated state of consciousness where they're in complete bliss, their body levitates, because now it's the spirit carrying that. It's like the magnetic field of that magnet carrying the weight of the magnet, so what? It's the weight of a magnet.
Cool. Thank you. That was awesome.
Yeah.